वेलकम अगेन. विल बी स्टार्टिंग द एनसीईआरटी क्लास 10 ज्योग्राफी चैप्टर 4 दैट डील्स विद एग्रीकल्चर. नाउ द फर्स्ट एंड द फॉरमोस्ट थिंग टू अंडरस्टैंड हियर इज एग्रीकल्चर इज इम्पॉर्टेंट टू स्टडी स्पेसिफिकली इन अ कंट्री लाइक इंडिया वेर नियरली 2/3 ऑफ द पॉपुलेशन सर्वाइव्स और थ्राइव्स ऑन एग्रीकल्चरल एक्टिविटीज और अलाइड एक्टिविटीज. नाउ एग्रीकल्चर इज इम्पॉर्टेंट नॉट ओनली बिकॉज वी गेट फूड ग्रेन्स बट इट इज अ काइंड ऑफ रॉ इट प्रोवाइड्स रॉ मटीरियल फॉर द वेरियस इंडस्ट्रीज. So you have the kind of primary sector that is important here, and this primary sector is a source of raw material for the secondary sector activities. Now we'll first understand the various basic types of agricultural activities. The first that we'll talk about today is the primitive farming. This is a kind of farming which occurs in small patches of land. You have primitive tools or not modernized. They are kind of hose or sticks that you are using to plow the farm. It's highly dependent on the monsoon activities. The most common activity here is the slash and burn agriculture. So you have a piece of land, you grow crops on this land, you burn this land and move to a next farm in the next season. You leave this land as such, you leave this land fallow, and then what would happen is within 1 or 2 years or 2 or 3 years, this land would regain its fertility, and then you would move further and come back onto the same patch of land. Since you are moving around, we call this activity as jhooming activity in the northeast areas of India. Now this slash and burn activity or slash and burn agriculture is known by various names in various parts of the world. So you have for the Mexico and the Central Africa, both the name starts with M. However, it's important that you remember the correct name for the correct region. So you have Milpa in Mexico and Masalo in Central Africa. You have Roca in Brazil, Ladang in Indonesia, and so on. So all these names you must remember. So these are the international names like for the slash and burn agriculture. When it comes to India, we do not have a unified name across the country. In different parts of India, you have the same practice that is known by different names, and this is a kind of commonly asked question for most of the objective examinations. So for example, in Madhya Pradesh you call this as Bewar or Dhaiya. However, again close to Madhya Pradesh you have Chhattisgarh. In Chhattisgarh you call it as Deepa. Manipur it is Pamlu. In northeastern states, as we said, it is known as jhooming cultivation. So if there can be a kind of short note, write a note on jhooming cultivation, or write a note on Pama Dhabi or Koman. So all these are kind of slash and burn agriculture, and these are the different names for those which are popularly practiced in different parts of the nation. So you must remember these. Now next is the difference between the intensive subsistence farming and the extensive farming. When we say intensive subsistence farming, that means we have a small plot of land. That small plot of land is highly populated. So you have high population density that is present in that land area. The land holdings are small. There is more chemicals and irrigation practices that are used. However, under extensive agriculture, you have huge patch of land commonly seen in the areas of, let's say, United States. So you have huge areas. You would have a kind of single farmhouse within this region. All the agriculture would be mechanized. That would be done by tractors and big machineries. However, here it's mainly labor intensive because it's such a small patch of land that you cannot use mechanized inputs in this. So this is the basic difference between the intensive and the extensive farming. Again, extensive farming is also known as commercial farming. So rice, for example, is practiced as commercial crop in Haryana and Punjab. However, in parts of Odisha, the same crop is practiced as subsistence. The word subsistence farming again denotes one specific thing, that is, you are growing enough to meet the need of your family and your peer group. However, you are not in a position to supply more, or you are not producing for the purpose of exports. So when you are talking about subsistence farming, it's mainly predominantly satisfying the local needs of the agricultural produce. Now the next important is plantation cropping. Plantation cropping Usually, you have a single monocultural crop that is grown on a huge patch of land. So, it's a kind of interface between agriculture and industry. So, you have large set of land, it's capital intensive, you are putting in a lot of money. Previously, when it started with the British era. However, now, most of the tea plantations are owned by Indians only. Most of the people who work on these plantation farms are migrant laborers. For example, you have tea plantations in Assam and North West Bengal. Again, you have coffee plantations in Karnataka. And for all these, what you need is a very good transport to reach the market. So, it's a kind of very market-oriented activity. Now, this is a very, very important slide. And if you remember this slide, you are sure to solve most of the objective questions where most of the people are stuck up. So, there are predominantly three seasons, the Kharif season, Rabi season and Zayat season. For your convenience, I have taken a single color for each of the seasons. So, there is no confusion left. Now, Kharif crop is sown in monsoon and harvested in October or September. As soon as the Kharif crop is gone, you have Rabi crop, which is sown in the winter seasons and harvested in the summer in the month of April to June. The intermediate period between the Rabi and the Kharif is occupied by Zayat. So, Zayat is predominantly vegetation, fodder crops, watermelon, muskmelon, cucumbers. So, all those are part of Zayat. So, Zayat is the smallest and it's over. The next is Rabi. Rabi, the predominant crops are wheat, barley, peas, grams and mustard. Now, important to note here is, among the pulses, there are few pulses which are part of Rabi crop. However, few pulses which are part of Kharif crop. So, you have peas and grams which are part of Rabi. However, tuwar, moong and udat are part of Kharif crop. The areas where Rabi is grown is mainly Punjab, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Jammu Kashmir, Uttaranchal and Uttar Pradesh. The remaining parts you have predominantly Kharif crop. Again, Kharif crop, you have rice that is grown in Bihar, Assam and Odisha. So, you have three seasons of rice and they are known as Os, Aman and Boro. So, these are the three crops of rice that are grown, or paddy. So, rice is also known as paddy. So, those are the three crops of rice that are grown under the Kharif cultivation and they are known as Os, Aman and Boro. That's again important. So, jute, cotton, groundnut, soybean are all part of Kharif crops. Now, let's talk about one by one crop in detail. So, first is rice. After China, India is the largest producer. As we said, it's a Kharif crop. It requires a high temperature more than 25 degrees Celsius with high humidity. The rainfall should be more than 100 centimeters. If it is less, paddy cultivation is possible only by agriculture. Most of the plains of north and northeast, the coast and the delta areas have rice cultivation. The areas of Rajasthan, Punjab, Haryana, West Uttar Pradesh and parts of Gujarat have shown good cultivation of rice by means of canal and tube well irrigation. Now, wheat cultivation, it's a Rabi crop. So, you have Rabi crop, so you have, it comes next to rice in terms of production. North and northwest of India, you have the wheat cultivation. It occurs in the cold growing season. It requires right amount of sunshine when it is ripening. The rainfall is moderate, from 50 to 75 centimeters. There are two zones, the Ganga Satluj plains in northwest and the black soils in the Deccan area. So, the northwest and the Deccan area on the map of India would be the major areas where you would have the wheat cultivation. The next is millets. Now, millets, the three important millets that we will be discussing today are jowar, bajra and ragi. Ragi is commonly grown in South India. So, you have kind of red, black and shallow loamy soil that you have ragi production. Ragi is rich in iron and calcium. It is, the highest production is seen in Karnataka, followed by Tamil Nadu, Himachal Pradesh. There are few traces of ragi that are found in Sikkim, Jharkhand and Arunachal Pradesh. Bajra is mainly grown in sandy and shallow black soils, commonly seen in the areas of Rajasthan, followed by Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra. So, bajra, you have R here and R for Rajasthan. So, you have highest producer is Rajasthan. Again, jowar, inverse the letter W. So, you have M. So, Maharashtra is the highest producer. Take a note, don't confuse this inversion. as Madhya Pradesh. So that's some of the common mistakes that most of the candidates do. So make sure you are just inversing it and you are trying to remember that when you are inversing, its W becomes M. So you have Jowar for highest production in Maharashtra. So all these are coarse grains. Coarse grains have rich fiber content and they have high nutrition value. The next is maize. It's a food and a fodder crop, predominantly a kharif crop. However, in Bihar, it is a rabi crop. So all the exceptions that are coming here are very, very important. So for example, maize is a rabi crop in Bihar is important because it's a kharif crop that is commonly known, and that's okay, that can be asked, but this is much more important when it comes from examination perspective. Again, pulses. India is the largest producer and consumer of the world pulses. It is a high source of protein diet. All are leguminous except tuwar. This exception again is important. So all the pulses are predominantly leguminous, which have nitrogen fixation, except tuwar. They can grow in dry seasons, and these are the north and the northwest areas are predominant areas of pulses production. The next is sugarcane. Sugarcane is grown both in North India and South India. Now the temperature is from 21 degrees to 27 degrees, rainfall between 75 to 100 centimeters. India is the second largest producer after Brazil. It is a kind of tropical and a subtropical crop. You have parts of North India and South India where you have sugarcane production, and you have sugar and jaggery as the products that you get from sugarcane industry. The next is oilseed. Again, India is the largest producer in the world. It occupies 12% of the total area. The common oilseeds that you can see are coconut, mustard, coconut, soya bean, castor, and so on. The few most important we would be discussing here are linseed and mustard. Important to note, they are rabi crops and predominantly grown in Maharashtra. Sesame is a kharif crop in the north and rabi crop in the south. So again, this is important. So you have sesame as a rabi crop in the South India and kharif crop in the North India. Castor is both a rabi as a kharif crop. Groundnut accounts for 50% of the oilseed production. The largest groundnut production is seen in Andhra Pradesh. That is again important. The next is coffee. 4% of the world coffee is supplied by India. It is started in the Babubudhan hills. It is grown as a plantation crop mainly in the Nilgiris in Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu. The junction of these three, you have the Nilgiris, and where you have the coffee production. The first variety of coffee, that was Arabica, came from Yemen. The next is horticulture. Again, India is the largest producer of fruits and vegetables in the world. You have 13% of the world's vegetables that are grown. Now these are the some basic areas. So apple, pear, apricot, walnuts are commonly seen in Jammu Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh. You have pineapples in Meghalaya, grapes in Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra, banana in southern India and northeast. You have oranges in Nagpur, and Cherrapunji is important. So Nagpur oranges are famous, but Cherrapunji is again important for oranges. So that's important to note. So wherever you have kind of some deviations from the normal that you have heard of, those are important. Then comes the rubber crop. From the rubber crop, you get the latex. So that latex is used for rubber industry. It's a kind of equatorial crop. India stands fifth in the world. Grown in the moist and humid conditions. If the rainfall is more than 200 centimeters and temperature is more than 25 degrees Celsius. Commonly seen in the southern coastal states. And then you have Andaman, Nicobar and Garo hills in Meghalaya that are important for rubber production. When it comes to fiber, there are four major fibers: cotton, jute, hemp and silk. Out of these, only silk is derived from silkworm or is an animal produce. This practice of silkworm rearing and cultivation of silk is known as sericulture. Cotton, jute and hemp are all obtained from plant. Jute is also known as golden fiber. Now the basic thing to know here is, when there was division of India from Bangladesh took place, most of the industries remained in India while the production units remained in Bangladesh. So there was a kind of decline in the jute production, and the jute industry suffered heavy losses. However, later on it was recovered. It is also known as golden fiber. Again, Now jute is being replaced by synthetic and artificial fibers because production of jute involves higher cost. The last is cotton, the most important. India is the third largest producer, grown technically in the black soil of Deccan area, requires high temperature, light rainfall, and the most important is 210 days of frost free season. So you have 210 days that should be frost free days. It's again a kharif crop. It requires 6 to 8 months to mature, and these are the major areas where you have grown, where you have cotton that is grown mainly in the Deccan belt. The next is the various reforms in agriculture. Now, when it comes to reform, you have insurance, credit card schemes for farmers, you have white and green revolution that took place, but that was concentrated to few areas. It was not able to spread. Consolidation of land is important now because with the smaller farms, it is difficult to diversify agriculture and produce or mechanize agriculture. So you have consolidation of land holdings that started with the first 5-year plan, the cooperative farming, abolition of zamindari, Grameen Bank's establishment. Now, Gandhiji talked about Gram Swaraj, and Vinoba Bhave focused on Bhudan or Gram Dan, which was also known as bloodless revolution. So under this, what happened was there was Mr. Ramchandra Reddy who divided his 80 acres of land among 80 landless laborers. So there was a kind of Bhudan or Gram Dan that took place. So again, this is important. So these were some of the basic reforms that took place in agriculture. Agriculture plays an important role in Indian economy. However, the share in terms of GDP is declining. As we said in the class in economics, class 10, where we talked about that we have more than 50% of the people who are engaged in agricultural activity, but they generate less than 25% of the GDP. That means there is a kind of huge unemployment or a kind of underemployment and disguised unemployment that is present in agriculture. To reform agriculture, we need to establish more agricultural universities, pursue research and development, veterinary services, animal breeding services, and horticulture development. However, there are certain issues that agriculture is facing. First of all, the farmers are withdrawing the investment in agriculture. They are trying to invest more in allied activities. There is decrease in the subsidies, higher competition from the foreign market, and decrease in the import duty. You have cheaper agricultural produces that are coming in from other countries. So that is decreasing the agriculture output or the agricultural production, affecting the agriculture in India per se. Now, food security, we have already covered this under economics class 9th. The basic idea is India as a country tries to provide food to each and every common man at an affordable price. Now, what does government do to ensure this? Government sets up the minimum support price that is given to the farmer in lieu of the food grain that is purchased by the government. So let's say even if there is a drought year, government would provide that minimum support price to the farmer so that he has a decent standard of living. Now, once the government has procured that, the government would supply it to the below poverty line people mainly through the fair price shops or the ration shops, and this system is known as the public distribution system. So public distribution system, along with the buffer stock that is maintained, helps to provide food security to the farmers as well as to the common man at an affordable price. However, of late it was discovered there are numerous drawbacks that this scheme is facing, because this food grain that is coming in is of low quality, there is no proper storage, and again when it is supplied into open market, and there are intermediaries who gain out of it. So these were some of the drawbacks that food security program witnessed. However, again there has been a change in the trend. Now the trend is shifting from predominantly a food crop, we are moving towards horticultural activities or growing more of vegetables and fruits. This is leading to decrease in the amount of cultivation of the pulses. So you have lesser amount of food grains that are diverted to the FCI for public distribution. Again, fertilizers used to show very good results for cropping. Of recent, it has been discovered that it is because of these fertilizers only that the land is being degraded. So now we are moving on or switching on to organic farming. So there is a kind of shift in the agricultural practices that is seen. Again, the groundwater pumping had been an important source of watering in most of the parts of India. because it was sustainable till a level, now it has gone beyond the sustainable level. The water tables have gone deep and there is more issue of water scarcity or water shortages in most of part of the world. What is the impact of globalization on agriculture? When it comes to the impact of globalization, let's talk about something from the historical background. So cotton mills in India were the main attraction areas for Britishers, from where they took the cotton and tried to export or send it to Manchester and Liverpool, which developed as cotton textile centers. Later on, there were kind of marginal farmers that developed around, and these marginal farmers need to improve. So there were movements like Champaran movement. So people in Champaran were forced to grow indigo because indigo could earn them good money. However, these people in the local farms wanted to grow the local crops or the food crops to sustain their families, but they were forced to grow indigo. So these were some of the initial phases which started with the plantation and a kind of forced cropping mechanism that started. Of recent, there has been a change in the pattern. Now we are shifting more towards a kind of gene revolution or genetic engineering, where we are bringing in more hybrid seeds which can produce more in shorter duration and the output could be much higher. There is diversification of crops from cereal crops to high value crops. So we are moving to crops like fruits, medicinal crops, flowers and vegetables. And what is happening is, of present, we are thinking of importing the cereals and exporting these high value crops, because when we are exporting these crops, we can get more money in the economy and we have to spend less to import the cereals. So this model has already been practiced by countries like Italy and Israel. Italy is predominantly the Mediterranean country, so you have most of the wine and the citrus cultivation that is seen here. Again, there has been a move to the biodiesel crops like jatropha and jojoba, which require less irrigation and can grow in dry conditions. So these are some of the changes that occur with the time, and there have been an impact of globalization. Because of opening up, we are trying to get models from other countries and moving on to high value crops for agricultural activities. We'll be covering more topics. Till then, you can subscribe to our channel to get more updates on the related topics. Have a good day ahead.